Wonderful. Thank you all for coming. We're very happy to have Miguel here. He's been doing all sorts of interesting things on a wide variety of topics. And today he's going to tell us about a really novel sort of baryogenesis. Miguel, whenever you're ready, take it away.
Oh, let me share my screen. Can you see it? Perfect. Cool. So, hi there, everyone. My name is Miguel Escudero and I'm a Alexander for Humboldt Fellow here in TUM in Munich. I'm broadly interested in fundamental physics and in particular in dark matter, baryogenesis, dark energy, and neutrinos. And in this seminar, I'm going to tell you about a mechanism for baryogenesis and dark matter production from the CP violating oscillations and subsequent decays of B-mesons in the early universe that we have named B-Mesogenesis. And so the seminar is going to be based upon two references. So this first one with Guillermo and Nelson, and in this reference we develop the mechanism. And also upon this one with Gonzalo Alonso Álvarez and also with Gilly, where we look in detail into the collider signatures of the mechanism. So let me jump straight to it. So the main features of B-mesogenesis are that first, baryogenesis and dark matter are linked. Within this mechanism, the baryon asymmetry of the universe is directly related to B-meson observables at collider experiments. If this mechanism is at play in the early universe, it would lead to unique collider signatures. And it's precisely because of these unique collider signatures that we expect the mechanism to be fully testable at current collider experiments. And these two last points is what we look into detail in this reference from 2 months ago. So before I tell you all the features about B-mesogenesis, let me first review what is our current understanding of the universe. So I bet you have seen this chart pie 1,000 times by now, but I'm going to show it again. So we are living in a universe with 5% of matter in terms of energy content, 26% of in terms of dark matter, and the remaining 69% in terms of dark energy. And we have actually measured rather precisely each of these components. So this is observationally, but how much of it do we understand? Or to put it in another way, what fraction of the energy density of the universe comes from physics beyond the standard model? And the answer to this question is 99.85%. If it were for the standard model, we should be living in a universe dominated by radiation with just photons and neutrinos. So what do we know about each of the components? Well, about dark energy, theoretically, I would say that not much. Data is consistent with a cosmological constant, and we have a handle on its equation of a state, but from the theoretical perspective, you know, we don't know if this is an evolving fluid, and if it's a constant, we have no idea why the constant is so small. Regarding dark matter, we don't know either what it is, but at least we know that the CMB anisotropies motivate a particle description of it, and we have many candidates, WIMPs, axions, stellar neutrinos. And I think the good thing is that as of today, we have existing experimental constraints on these various possibilities. And given current and planned experiments, within 10, 20 years, we could discover dark matter if it's made out of one of these most popular candidates. And if not, then new candidates will come into play. Finally, we have baryons. So at least this component of the universe, we know what it is. They are protons and neutrons. The only problem is that we don't understand why they are there. We observe a universe with only matter and no antimatter. And that's puzzling because from experiment, we see that matter and antimatter appear to interact in almost the same way. So how is that we end up living in a universe with only matter and no antimatter? And the small number of baryons per photon point towards a very small primordial asymmetry in the early universe at the level of 10 to the minus 9 between the number of baryons and antibaryons in the early universe. So our aim with the mechanism was to provide us with an understanding of what dark matter could be and why are we living in a universe with only matter and no antimatter. So this is the outline of the talk. First, I'm going to tell you what are the main ingredients and features of the B-Mesogenesis mechanism. Then I will illustrate it with a minimal model and highlight the cosmology. Then I will move into what I think is the most interesting part, which is what are the implications for collider experiments. I will discuss the dark matter phenomenology, and then I will summarize and say some words for outlook. So please feel free to stop me at any time. The beginning, maybe I try to make it not too technical. Here, maybe things get a little bit more technical, but feel free to stop me at any time and make questions and comments, please. So already in 1967, Sakharov outlined what are the three necessary conditions in order to explain a universe like the one we observe, meaning one in which matter has dominated over antimatter, in which we only observe matter. So the first Sakharov condition is CNCP violation. If one wants to generate an excess of matter over antimatter in the early universe, the rate of producing particles and antiparticles need to be different. So you need to violate both C and CP. In addition, one needs to be out of thermal equilibrium, because in thermal equilibrium, the number of particles and antiparticles is the same. So it's impossible to generate an asymmetry. And finally, if the excess of particles over antiparticles one wants to generate in the early universe is of baryons, which is our case, then one needs baryon number violating interactions. So how do we address each of these conditions? So the first condition is C and CP violation, and here's where the main novelty of the mechanism comes in, and this was the key idea of Mesons, which was, well, let's put into use a naturally occurring CP violating system in the standard model, which is the neutral B meson system. So we have three neutral and CP violating oscillating systems in the standard model. We have kaons, D mesons, and B mesons. However, kaons and D mesons are not good for baryogenesis because they are too light. They cannot decay into baryons. So we cannot use them to produce baryogenesis. On the other hand, then B meson system, and in particular the neutral B mesons, are the perfect system because they weigh 5.3 GeV and they can indeed decay into baryons, and they do so. So a brief overview of the B meson. So it's a meson system. It's composed out of a B quark and a light quark. And this is the case for the B sub S, and the B sub D will just have a D there. The lifetime is around 1.5 picoseconds, and we know they oscillate. So the B sub S meson, for example, will oscillate roughly 9 times before it decays, while a B sub D meson will oscillate, will perform 1/4 of an oscillation before decay. And here I took this plot from a paper by LHCb, where you can see explicitly how B mesons oscillate. So you can see they oscillate, they change flavor, they go from B0 to B0 bar, and they decay after some time. So why B mesons oscillate? Well, in the standard model, they oscillate because the CKM matrix is non-diagonal. So the flavor eigenstates do not correspond to the mass eigenstate. And the reason is simply, again, the CKM matrix is non-diagonal, and then there is mass and width mixing in the B-meson system, given by these typical box diagrams. So that explains why, in the standard model, B-mesons oscillate. But in order to have CP violation, one requires not only oscillation, but also a phase, a relative phase between these two quantities, between the width mixing and the mass mixing. So this is in the standard model, and beyond the standard model, there are many scenarios that can actually contribute to the neutral B meson mixing, and in particular to the mass mixing. And these are there are very, very many, including C-prime models, leptoquarks, etc. So how do we actually measure the CP violation in the neutral B meson system? The key quantity, and I'm going to use it through the talk, is the same leptonic asymmetry, this ASL. And we have one. I think there is a comment or question.
Wondering, like, why you always compare to twice the proton mass, in order to say say the D meson doesn't work. Like, what's the reason behind?
So it's lighter than twice the proton mass. And then if we have, say, in the standard model, they cannot decay into proton is the lightest baryon, so that's it. You cannot decay into standard model baryons at least. Mm-hmm. One could imagine having a, say, dark sector baryon, and then the decay could happen. Mm-hmm. But then the proton will be unstable, and we know the proton is not unstable.
Wait, but Miguel, couldn't you imagine, for example, having these decays take place in a weird scenario where you've quenched the electroweak phase transition or something so that you're decaying a lighter meson into three quarks and some other stuff, so that if the quarks are massless while this is happening, you could still do it, right?
But then how do you form the mesons?
I mean, you go through the, well, that's a good point.
So provided that there are no time variations on the masses of some of the particles, I think it may be a fair statement. But those time variations could occur in the early years. I don't know. There could be scenarios, I guess. But in vacuum, I think this holds. And even if you invent a particle that carries baryon number, the proton will be unstable, and then you will be in trouble. Does that? I don't know who asked the question. I don't know if it solves that.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, yeah. Please, thank you for the question, and please, and also Gordon, feel free to interrupt me at any time. So how do we measure the CP of violation in the neutral B-meson system? So as I was saying, the key quantity is the same electronic asymmetry, this ASL, and we have two, one for the P sub D and one for the P sub S meson. And in terms of the mixing is defined as the imaginary part of the width and the mass mixing. Small technicality, but in terms of things that we can measure is essentially the number of times a B meson decays into a particle minus the number of times a B meson decays into an antiparticle divided by the sum of the two. So it's very clear that if this number is different from zero, then CP is not a good quantum, is not conserved in the B meson system. Of course, the electroweak interactions violate CP, and therefore these numbers are non-zero in the standard model, and they are given by these quantities. So they are at the level of 10 to the minus 4 for the B sub D and 10 to the minus 5 for the B sub S. And they are small simply because there is a large hierarchy between the bottom and top quark mass. And then these predictions in the standard model should be compared with observations, and these are the current war averages. So what you can see from the current measurements is that they are compatible with zero, so no CP violation in the neutral B-meson system for the moment. And they have error bars at the level of the per mil. So if you compare the numbers, the standard model predictions versus measurements, the B sub D1 is a factor of 4 smaller than current error bars, and the B sub S1 is a factor of 100 smaller than current error bars. And again, this is the standard model prediction, but there are many beyond the standard model scenarios, including supersymmetry, star dimensions, electroquarks, C-prime models, that can take these numbers and enlarge them up to the level of 1 per mil. So BSM scenarios can, you know, these quantities can be used to constrain BSM scenarios, and these numbers can be enlarged in general beyond the standard model. So that was the first Sakharov condition, CP violation in the neutral B-meson system. So we know it already happens in the standard model, and then beyond it could happen. And the second one is out of equilibrium, so we need to be in an out of equilibrium condition, and also we need to produce B mesons. So how do we actually do that? Because we want to generate a lot of B mesons in the early universe in order to do baryogenesis. So in order to achieve that, we require the presence of an out of equilibrium particle that dominates the energy density of the universe and decays and reheats it to a temperature of 10-20 MeV. So for this to happen, this particle should be very weakly coupled and should have a lifetime around the millisecond. Now, this particle could be the inflaton itself, it could be a moduli, or simply an out of equilibrium decaying particle, but be nice to have a lifetime of around a millisecond. Now, one may think that having a reheating temperature of 10, 20 maybe is dangerous cosmologically, because you essentially want to start second the universe, but this is not the case, because provided that the temperature is larger than 5 MeV, these decays will not spoil the successful predictions of organic resynthesis or the very precise measurements of Planck CMB observations. So provided that you are above 5 MeV, you reproduce the universe we observe.
Miguel, what sets a scale of 10 MeV exactly then?
So essentially the lifetime. Essentially the lifetime. So this particle will reheat the lifetime essentially will be compared with the Hubble rate, so 1 over h. And then when this happens, that will occur at temperatures of 10, 20 maybe.
Okay.
So that means is when the particle is really decaying and then reheats the universe.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. So that assess the out of equilibrium condition, but how do we produce B mesons? Well, if this particle that is out of equilibrium is a scalar particle, and I will call it capital phi, and it has a mass above the B quark threshold, then it will generically decay into B quarks. Now, these B quarks are produced at temperatures of 10, 20 MeVs, which are way below the QCD phase transition, which is 200 MeV. So that means that actually these B quarks will quickly hadronize and indeed produce B mesons. So with this, we are able to generate a large number of B mesons in the early universe. And the last thing one needs to check is that these B mesons are not producing vacuum. They are producing the early universe. And the universe is a hot dense plasma of electrons and positrons. Now, even though the B-meson system is spinless and chargeless, it's made up of two quarks, and therefore it has a small charge distribution. So these electrons and positrons can interact actually with these B-mesons and potentially they cohere the CP baryodine oscillations that we need in order to generate baryogenesis. So we explicitly check what is the rate of this process. And then we found that this will not happen. The coherence will be maintained for temperatures below 20, 30 MeV. So this is precisely why that mechanism needs to work at temperatures that are rather low, 20, 30 MeV, because otherwise the oscillations will be decohere.
Can I ask a question here?
So yeah, definitely.
I guess you're imagining some microscopic theory in which some heavy scalar particle primarily coupled to B quarks. Right, and then it decays around the 10 to the minus 3 seconds. But then when B quarks hadronizes, what is the probability of it turns into B meson other than other state? Is it primarily going into the B meson or?
So that's a very good question. Actually in the early unit, in this context, that's an uncertainty in our calculation. We don't really know, but given the masses that we are considering, which is between 10 to 100 GeVs, we took the ansatz of the C peak. So the decays of the C into B quarks produce 40% of the time B plus B minus, 40% of the time B zeros, 10% of the time B supers, and 10% of the time B flavor baryons.
Okay.
You know, one could imagine these numbers changing slightly, but not too much.
And another question is, mm-hmm. when I'd imagine that the reheat temperature will vary as you change the mass of this heavy particle phi, right? For example, if it were like 100 GeV particle decaying into the B quarks, then B will carry characteristic momentum of 50 GeV or so. And then if you assume that there is a, of course, at 50 GeV, send them out the gauge couplings at atomic equilibrium. So they will just normalize by themselves, right? Mm-hmm. And then up to degrees of freedom of order 100, it will normalize it around the tens of GeV temperature rather than the 20 MeV that you wanted to achieve. What am I missing?
So essentially the story is the following. So true, this particle will produce big quarks of half of the mass of energy, right? And these big ones will decay and produce, you know, electrons, positrons, neutrinos, and these particles will interact. However, given that the lifetime is a millisecond, the number of internal degrees of freedom in the plasma is, say, 20, and the temperature that corresponds to the Hubble rate at these lifetimes is 10-20 MeV. So, you know, even though you produce these particles that are very energetic, you don't produce that many. So the final state temperature will be 10-20 MeV, will not be half of the mass of this particle.
Ah, I see. So basically the abundance of by the time you start decaying is already Boltzmann suppressed. So even if you decay away all of them, you don't get to actually heat it up all the way up to the intensity.
No, this phi is not Boltzmann suppressed. It has some abundance and actually it's rather large. But the key thing is that at the time of decay, the temperature is just determined by the lifetime. If all the things that you inject thermalize.
Miguel, if I have this right, this is just the instant reheating approximation, right?
We consider the time dependence, but
I mean, just assuming that all of the energy in whatever is out of equilibrium decaying goes into the thermal G star degrees of freedom, right? Yeah. So I think, that should be, standard.
So even though these particles are highly energetic, they will lead to a plasma that is not that highly energetic. And the temperature at which it will happen will be just controlled by the lifetime. That's
okay. Okay, so maybe complementing the question by Sungu. So the abundance of phi that you mentioned, that if phi is not thermalized, then, that is true. So what sets the abundance of phi then?
That's a good point. So I said here that it dominates the energy density of the universe that could be postulated. To be specific, we didn't actually require that, but you know, these are technicalities. What we assume is that at temperatures similar to the mass of this capital phi, these particles decouple from the plasma. So if it has a mass of, say, 100 GeVs, it decouples at a temperature of 100 GeVs and then decays.
And then remains until it decays, I see. So simply,
decoupling while relativistic, which is a fair thing to do in the sense that the number of internal degrees of freedom in the standard model don't change too much.
Very good. So it's decoupled from the plasma at temperatures of 100 GeV. So therefore the evolution, its abundance is well known. And because it's
and essentially it dominates the universe in the sense that it has an energy density that is way larger than the standard model bath.
Very good, very good.
And decouples, you know, consistent with the lifetime. Because the lifetime implies a
sure. Definitely.
Right. Okay, that makes sense. Okay. Basically 100 GeV times n cubed is of the order of 100 MeV to the fourth. That's the requirement. Right. Energy density that phi carried when it started decaying, dumped into the standard model plasma, is of the order of the t to the fourth with the tenth of MeVt.
Yes.
Good, thanks. I understand, thanks.
Thank you. So, cool. So I think with this question, which I thank you for, I think we have clarified out of equilibrium and production of B-mesons, which is very nice. And now we can move into the third Sakharov condition, which is baryon number violation. And here I actually put a question mark, because actually in our setup, baryon number is conserved. And this is in a similar spirit to hylogenesis by tooling and collaborators. So, you know, if baryon number violation is a Sakharov condition and we conserve it, how do we actually generate baryogenesis? The trick here is that we make dark matter an antibaryon and generate an asymmetry between the matter in the visible sector and the antimatter in the dark sector, thanks to the CP violating oscillations and subsequent decays of B mesons in the early universe. So the idea will be the following. We will be able to generate an excess of particles in the visible sector, and these are the baryons that we observe, and an excess with the same number, but with a minus sign in terms of baryon number in the dark sector, and these particles will be the dark matter. So in that way, total baryon number of the universe is zero, but we are able to generate both baryogenesis and dark matter. And key to the mechanism, the B mesons should decay into dark matter and a visible baryon. Otherwise, this doesn't work.
So then, of course, at these temperatures, the baryon number interactions, the spiral interactions are totally suppressed. So that's why you need this. So there is no baryon number violation unless you impose it. Okay, very good, very good.
So, I mean, there are other possibilities, like, so this, I think, is a choice. One can choose. So I think the choice is motivated by the fact that we hadn't observed any baryon violating process. But one could have chosen to actually violate the decay, the baryon number in the decay. The problem is then that you don't have an understanding for dark matter, and you are heating the universe at temperatures of 10, 20 MeVs. So you don't really have too much cosmological time to do anything, right?
And it's probably very dangerous, right? Because if we propagate at the loop level to the proton, probably at some point.
It depends upon what the masses that you choose are. And,
right. It depends on technicalities.
Yes.
Okay.
So with this, I arrive to a summary of B-mesogenesis. So we have an out-of-equilibrium latent decaying particle. It decays into big quarks and it hits the universe at temperatures of 10, 20 MeVs. These big quarks quickly hadronize and produce B-mesons. And then the neutral components of these B-mesons undergo CP-violating oscillations. Then all the B-mesons decay, and they decay into dark sector antibaryons and visible baryons. And thanks to the CP-violating oscillations, we are able to generate an excess of matter in the visible sector, and we explain baryogenesis, and an excess of antimatter, antibaryons, in the dark sector. And that gives us an understanding for dark matter. And as I advertised in the introduction, if you follow this chain of events, then you find that the baryon asymmetry of the universe, so the number of baryons divided by the number of photons today, is directly related to two observables at collider experiments. One of them is the branching fraction of a decay mode of a B meson decaying into a dark sector antibaryon, a visible baryon, and any number of pions. And the other one is the semi-leptonic asymmetry, ASL, that measures the CP violation in the neutral B meson system. And it's precisely because of this relationship that we can actually test, as I will discuss now, the mechanism.
Actually, Miguel, before you move on, I just ask, your story, does it matter at all whether the first step in this chain has any CP violation? In other words, if I could just choose that to be real, I can decouple whatever CP violation I'm getting in the middle step.
That is a very good point, very good question. So this formula is totally insensitive to the CP violating nature of this coupling. And the reason is the following. This coupling, say this particle has a mass of 100 GeVs, it has a lifetime of a millisecond, which means it couples, the coupling that enters here is 10 to the minus 10. Now, the CP violation will enter at the level of at least, you know, the one loop level. Actually, when you do this carefully, it's the three loop level. And then it will be suppressed by powers of this coupling. So the CP violation coming from the CP violating nature of this coupling is negligible. That's why we need to use the CP violating oscillations of B-mesons. So at the end of the day, everything is going to be related to what these numbers actually are.
So just to follow up, maybe this is related to an earlier question that was asked, but when you do produce the B quarks from the first step of the decay, are you worried that they'll scatter off of the radiation bath such that it changes whether or not you would actually have a B meson that would travel that distance? Because the temperature here is pretty low.
Exactly. So we explicitly check that annihilations do not occur. So you are not going to miss this B meson, these B quarks before they hadronize. And then scatterings can occur. So this is what I highlighted here. So the particles are going to be hadronized, so the B mesons are produced, but then they may interact in a scattering manner, not annihilation, with the plasma. And this could be problematic because essentially this scattering measures the state of the B meson and that stops the CP violating oscillations. However, you know, we computed the rate explicitly and we take into account in our calculations, the rate is inefficient for temperatures of 20 30 MeV below that temperature, because essentially the rate depends as T to the 5, because this particle is chargeless, so it only interacts via charge radius interaction, and then the number density of these states goes like T cubed. So you know, these big quarks will hadronize and produce B-mesons, and then scatterings will be possible. They could modify the CP Baryogenesis oscillations, take that into account, and essentially the result is that you need to do it at temperatures below 20, 30 MeV. Otherwise, you don't oscillate in a CP Baryogenesis manner.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, cool. Any more questions? Now I'm going to move into a model. So maybe there is a question regarding the mechanism.
Yeah,
the
last question would be. I have one pretty quick question. So basically, are you going to take dark anti-baryon state to be 5 times roughly heavier than us, so that you just explain factor of 5, or you have other ways to adjust?
Sorry, can you repeat that? I missed something.
Yeah, because you don't have a B violation, basically abundance in the dark matter in terms of number density will be basically roughly the same as a baryon anti-asymmetry, as a baryon asymmetry in the standard model sector. So are you just taking the 5 times heavier state in the dark sector compared to us?
No, I'm going to explain that momentarily. That's a very good point. So that's what we are doing. But this particle cannot wait 5 GeV, so otherwise it cannot come from this decay.
Right. So,
I'm about to discuss that.
All right, I will go. Thanks.
Cool. So I'm going to move into a minimal model that realizes it. So this slide is a little bit intense. I will go step by step. So, you know, we need to trigger, and this is fundamental for the mechanism, a new decay mode of the B-meson into a dark sector anti-baryon and a visible baryon. So for that, we need a new force. We need a new force carrier, because in the standard model, this decay doesn't happen. And for that, we consider a color triplet scalar that we call Y. It has these quantum numbers, and then we know the mass should be above 1 TeV due to LHC constraints. And then this particle can couple to quarks, in particular, one big quark. We need it because the big one needs to decay. And here a U and a big quark, and then an S quark, and here a psi. So this psi is a dark sector antibaryon, so it's a standard model singlet, and carries baryon number. So it carries baryon number such that this interaction is baryon number conserving. Now, this particle, if it were the dark matter, so it cannot be the dark matter for various reasons. The first one is that it couples indirectly to 3 quarks. So it couples to an S quark, a U quark, and a B quark. And then through big weak loops, this particle will eventually decay back into visible matter on cosmological time scales. So in order not to have that, one requires additional species in the dark sector. And this additional species, the minimal possible version, is to have a scalar dark sector antibaryon and a Majorana dark sector fermion, both singles under the standard model gauge group and stabilized via discrete set two symmetry. So then these two states will be the dark matter in the universe, and there will be an asymmetry. So there will be this particle carries baryon number 1, and then there will be the very same number of these particles as the baryons that we have. But there could be more of this, because this is a Majorana fermion, and there could be more. But key is the kinematics, so the particles cannot be lighter than 1 GeV, because otherwise the proton will decay, will be unstable, and it is not. And the particles need to come from the decay of a B meson. So they should have a mass below 2.53 GeV.
These two are both stable?
These two are both stable, yes.
One cannot decay to the other.
That's also a very good point. They could, provided that the mass splitting is above mass of the proton plus mass of the electron, and then we require just that not to happen. So if they were to be two different in mass, then the heavier will eventually decay via weak loops into the lighter one plus a proton and an electron, and it will be problematic because we will lose the dawn, the baryogenesis, and then this cannot be dark matter, it will be unstable. So we require that these particles are somewhat close in mass.
What would not work? Sorry, my son is practicing piano. And,
So what
would not work if one
so decays? If one decays into the other, say this particle is heavier and it carries baryon number, and then decays into this one, emitting a proton and an electron, then this, well, actually an antiproton, this particle carries baryon number minus one, so it will decay into an antiproton and a positron. This antiproton will annihilate with a baryon, with a proton somewhere, and then we will lose the baryogenesis, right?
Okay, thanks.
As soon as one decays into the other, we are, so dark matter is unstable and it is not unstable, and then we lose baryogenesis. Maybe at late times, but you know, I think that would be problematic.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
Thank you for the question. And so this is the setup. So we need a new force carrier, this particle Y. And then one needs to plug in the numbers and calculate what this branching fraction could be. And this is the branching fraction that is key to baryogenesis, because it's directly telling you how much asymmetry there is between matter and antimatter in the early universe. And you plug in the numbers, and this branching fraction can be at the level of 10 to minus 3, 10 to minus 2, even larger, for masses of this particle at the TV scale, and for couplings similar to the ones that we observe in electroweak interaction. So this model does allow you to have a rather large branching fraction. So with this, I move into, so this is the minimal model. We need this new force carrier, and I move into how do we actually calculate the baryon asymmetry of the universe and the dark matter abundance. So I'm not going to discuss the details, not that the equations are too complicated, but I think it's worth just telling you what the results are. So one needs to take into account the expansion of the universe. This is the typical Hubble equation, the evolution of the number density of this out of equilibrium decaying particle, how this particle reheats the universe when it decays. Then we need to have a Boltzmann equation for each of the dark matter states. So this dark sector Majorana fermion, the anti-baryon scalar, and it's complex, you know, it's antiparticle. Typical terms, these account for possible annihilations within the dark sector. And then these last terms account for the production via phi decaying to p quarks, decaying to these states. One of the nice things about conserving baryon number is that the baryon asymmetry of the universe is simply the number of baryons in the dark sector minus the number of antibaryons in, sorry, the number of antibaryons in the dark sector minus the number of baryons in the dark sector. And then one can arrive to this compact equation for the baryon asymmetry that again is directly related to the semi-leptonic asymmetry, which is the measure of the CP violation in the neutral B-meson system, and the branching fraction of the new decay mode of a B-meson decaying to that missing energy, a visible baryon, and the number of pions. So you know, it's a direct relationship. And again, we take into account the decoherent effects in the early universe. So I'm not going to show you results of solving these equations. I think I can tell you more interesting things. We can discuss any details in the question time, but I think it's worth moving into what are the correlation signatures. So we need CP violation in the neutral B meson system. We also need the decay, the B meson to decay into dark matter, which will be missing energy in the detector and a visible baryon. And then for this decay to happen, we need a new force carrier, and this particle will be a Kolmogorov triplet scalar that should have a mass around the TV scale and that we can hope to test too. So this is the relevant parameter space. This is the semi-leptonic asymmetry in the B sub D meson. So the measure of CP violation in the B sub D, same for the B sub S meson. And here in orange and showing the current wall averages. So essentially current measurements on these quantities. This square is the standard model prediction. And then by solving, and so the averages are a result of LHCb, B0, BaBar, and Bell measurements, so they are combined. And solving the Boltzmann equation that I presented before, we can set what is the relevant parameter space for B-mesogenesis. And here in red, you can see all the parameter space in which B-mesogenesis will produce the observed baryon abundance in the universe and the observed dark matter abundance. So what you can see is that one of the key requirements is that this semi-leptonic asymmetry, at least one of them, should be positive. So we need one B meson at least to decay more into matter than antimatter, otherwise we don't generate the right thing. And it should be larger than 10 to the minus 5. So that's one of the first things to note. The second one is that these bands corresponds to the branching fraction of this new decay that we need. Comparing these bands to current measurements, we can see that the measured semi-electronic asymmetries tell us that this branching fraction, in order to explain the baryon asymmetry of the universe, needs to be larger than 10 to the minus 4. So with this, we have narrowed down the parameter space. And these semi-electronic asymmetries are not the only way we can measure the CP violation in the neutral B-Meson system, but if one performs a global fit to all oscillation and CP violating data in the B-Meson system, we can find also indirect constraints on these quantities, and this can be done using global fits. This is taken from UDFit. And if this global fit hold, and I must say there are some caveats, so I'm not going to take this number, but this is, I think it's useful to put, but there are some things that may not necessarily hold. It would imply that we need branching fractions that are larger than 10 to the minus 3. So somewhat large branching fractions, 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 3. And finally, there is overlap between our predictions and the standard model CP violation in the neutral B-Meson system. So this is not a mistake, it's true as of today. But you can see that it corresponds to rather large branching fractions. So branching fractions that are larger than 2.5%. So today, that is allowed by data, but it may not be soon. So this region of parameter space is going to be tested very soon, as I will discuss in a minute. So with this exploration of parameter space, we can we have narrowed down what are the relevant implications for collider experiments. So we need this new decay mode of the B-meson into missing energy for detector and a visible baryon should be larger than 10 to the minus 4, the branching fraction. There should be CP violation in the neutral B-meson system with a semi-electronic asymmetry that is positive and larger than 10 to the minus 5. And then in order to trigger this rather large branching fraction, the mass of the color triplet scalar that is responsible to mediate the interaction should be lighter than 10 TeV's. So there is hope to actually test it at ALDAS and CNS. So, you know, at this point in the talk, one may be wondering, well, there is any room for your new decay mode? And the answer is yes. And the reason is the following. So essentially we know the B-Meson system very well, and targeted decay modes are either very well constrained or well measured. So two examples of that are B factories tell us that the processes like B to K nu nu, so involving missing energy, things that we cannot reconstruct, are we have sensitivities at the level of 10 to minus 5. And then from the LHC, we know we have sensitivities at the level of 10 to minus 10 for processes involving, for example, two muons. So can we actually have such large branching fractions for all decays? And the answer is yes. And the reason is simply that our decay modes have not been targeted. So there is no search performed to date on the decay of a B meson decaying into a dark sector antibaryon that will be missing energy. We don't see this particle, a visible baryon, and any number of pions. This search hasn't been performed. So the best we could do was to look at the total decay of B mesons. And then from theory, we know that the standard model prediction for the decay rate agrees with measurements, but with an error bar of 20%. And that allows us to set a constraint at the 40% level. And then looking into the PDG, we found that, in fact, it is known that the B-meson decays into a proton and an antiproton, or an antiproton, sorry, plus anything else with a branching fraction of 8%, which means that our branching fraction cannot be larger than 10%, because any baryon that we generate will eventually produce a proton or an antiproton and will contribute to this inclusive rate. So as of today, the best bound that we can place is 10%, that is very loose, but actually I think we can do better, and is what I'm going to discuss now. So baryogenesis requires this branching fraction to be larger than 10 to the minus 4. And then, you know, B factories have a sensitivity on similar processes involving missing energy, like B2K nu nu at the level of 10 to the minus 5, which means that it is very likely that they have sensitivities at the level of 10 to minus 5 for a decay of a B-meson into missing energy plus a visible baryon. So in fact, there are ongoing searches using all BaBar and Belle data and with new data from Belle II. And you know, if they have the sensitivity that we expect they could have, they should be able to fully test the parameter space. We may, knowing exactly the sensitivity is a delicate because I have planned discussing this in the Outlook, but you know, it's likely that they will be able to test potentially an entire parameter space.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, let me let Yiming go first.
I just wonder which experiment did the proton antiproton inclusive search.
I think that this is a mixture between Argus and Cleo. So all experiments at the Upsilon 4S had one at DESI and the other one, I don't know. But yes, rather all experiments.
Thanks.
So I might have thought that this new decay mode could at least sometimes look like that kaon decay mode. Is it possible to reinterpret the bound on the kaon mode?
No, because the if you aim to reconstruct the kaon, which typically you do, then the baryon doesn't look like a kaon. So you don't measure the neutrinos, right?
Right. Yes.
But you try to measure the kaon decaying. But the kaon decaying looks like, doesn't look like a lambda or like a proton. It looks, it's trivial to actually get the bound, but it doesn't look the same.
Gotcha.
And then due to the fact that they don't look exactly the same, there is no bound. But the sensitivity should be similar.
Okay, good. Thank you.
So related to this, can I just ask one question really quickly?
Sure.
So the nature of the baryon in this B-meson decay depends on the second coupling you wrote down. So right in that coupling, you coupled it to the strange quark. But depending on other choice of that, the lambda, nature of lambda can change, right? And then in your last constraint, coming from the proton-antiproton measurement, are you assuming that this lambda, regardless of the details of the second coupling, would decay into proton plus something? And that's how you put the bound, or?
Yes. So even that, we have to make some assumptions, and indeed. So the lambda, for example, decays 67% of the time to a proton and a baryon, and the remaining to a neutron.
I see.
The neutron, you cannot measure, right? It's neutral. You know, if you may find some energy in the calorimeter, but you cannot measure it. But then the expectation is that, so this includes every single B meson. So B plus, B minus, B zero. And therefore, you should always find essentially the protons. You see what I mean? So
yes.
This is to the sum of the decays.
Right, I see, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the point. Yes, so this is the status. There are ongoing searches. They are actually targeting this decay because, so there are four possible variations. One can change the flavor of the quark here. This could be a D quark, and this could be a C quark. So there are four possibilities, and they are actually searching for this decay. And it is my understanding that we may find that they will show results in a few months' time. So this could change soon. This branch, in fact, this constraint very soon. Cool. So, that's the decay of B mesons. And now we need a particle that triggers the decay. And this particle is a color Tibetan scalar that could have these two quantum numbers. So it has the same quantum numbers as a supersymmetric square. And then, in order to trigger branching fractions that are larger than 10 to the minus 4, it should have a mass below 10 TeV. So the LHC can actually tell us something about this particle. So depending upon how it is produced and how it decays, it will lead to different type of signatures. So if it's pre-produced and decays into quarks, it will lead to a forged signature, and then the mass should be above 500 DeV. if it's pre-produced and decays into a jet and a dark sector particle, it will lead to a two jet transmission energy signal, and then the mass should be above 1.2 TeV's. And then if it's singly produced, and it can be because it couples, it has a dichord coupling, then if it decays into two quarks, it will lead to a dijet signature. And if it decays into a quark and a dark sector antibaryon, it will lead to a monojet signature. So what we did was to recast these bounds in order to set constraints on the couplings that directly enter the branching fraction, which is at the end in the mechanism related to the baryon asymmetry of the universe. So this is a typical example of how these constraints look like. So this is a coupling between the S and the P quark. This is a coupling between this, the standard model singlet state, and the U quark. And here I fix the mass to be 3 TeV's, so that, you know, just a number. And everything here above this line is excluded by the jet searches. Everything above this line is excluded by jets plus missing energy searches as of today. And then in red is the relevant region of parameter space in order to do a baryogenesis and dark matter production. So this is an example, but essentially by considering every single possible combination of couplings and masses, as of today, the LHCb tells us that actually this branching fraction indirectly should be less than 10%. So at the moment it's not very informative, but as you can see from this plot, the ATLAS and CMS have had a great potential to detect, to constrain this Colbert-Triplet scalar, and in particular coming from searches from jet plus missing energy, because you can see from here to there, there could be a rather large improvement. So with this, I think it's worth going back and having a look at the parameter space globally. So in order to produce the observed baryon asymmetry of the universe, we need a branching fraction times a semi-electronic asymmetry that is positive, that's critical. We need matter and no antimatter. And this product should be larger than 5 × 10⁻⁷. And as of today, we know that this product is less than 10⁻⁴, because we know this branching fraction should be less than 10%. And we know that this cannot be larger than 1 per mil, roughly. So the best way to test the parameter space is by taking all data from BaBar and Belle. You know, just take the data and search for it. And this is undergone. It's in progress. And it may fully test the parameter space. We don't know that estimating the actual sensitivity is not that easy, but it may be possible to fully test it. Then Belle 2 will have 40 times more luminosity than Belle. So for one could expect a factor of 40 improvement, and this could potentially fully test it too. And Belle 2 will also measure better the CP violation in the B-Meson system. So it will also, you know, improve this product of quantities. LHCb can measure very well the CP violation in the B-Meson system, and could also potentially, and this is under study, constrain this type of decay too. Sorry. And finally, ATLAS and CMS can also measure the CP violation in the B-Meson system, so constrain this quantity, and indirectly, as I showed before, constrain this branching fraction indirectly, because, you know, if you don't find this mediator, then this branching fraction cannot be too large. So again, the combination, so even if BaBar and Belle II do not test the full parameter space, which is possible, the combination of measurements from LHCb, ALDAS and CMS, and the other experiments should fully test, you know, will bring the combination of numbers, if they don't find anything, to something below this number. So it will be tested. So with this, I don't know what time is it. Okay. So there were many questions. I have like 5 more slides on the dark matter phenomenology, which I think is relevant, but.
Sure. If you want to take an extra 5 minutes or something.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I will go fast, but there were many questions at the center. So good. So yes, so the dark sector here is composed of 2 states in the minimal version of the mechanism and looks like this. So we have given that the masses are in this range, we have some types of particles and some others. So we see that the dark sector is partially asymmetric. And then we explore the full parameter space in order to see where do we obtain the observed dark matter abundance. And the observed dark matter abundance requires an irradiation cross-section in the dark sector, so in this case, these states, to have cross-sections that are roughly one order of magnitude larger than of a wing. And the reason to understand this is easy. These particles are produced out of equilibrium at temperatures of 20 MeV, say, half a mass of 1 GeV. So they are produced at temperatures one order of magnitude below the wing freeze out. So you need an irradiation cross-section that is order of magnitude larger in order to have roughly the same abundance. So yeah, given this large annihilation cross-section, it poses the question, well, what kind of dark sector could allow you to have such large annihilation cross-section while at the same time being compatible with the very stringent constraints coming from Planck CMB observation? So to highlight the point, this is a annihilation cross-section, this is the dark matter mass, everything above this region is excluded if you interact, if you annihilate it directly into something that interacts electromagnetically, and the annihilation is a wave, and we live there. So how? So what we did was to outline three possibilities for their sector. So the first one is that, well, maybe these states annihilate into stellar neutrinos, and this would be a good possibility because the annihilation into stellar neutrinos could be P wave. If it's P wave, then there are no constraints from CMB observations, and that sector is just fine. Another possibility will be to annihilate directly into active neutrinos. So it's very similar to the previous one, but just via mixing, you can annihilate into active neutrinos. And this will evade all known constraints because the constraints on dark matter annihilating into neutrinos are very mild. So similar plot as before, annihilation cross-section, in this case into neutrinos, as a function of the dark matter mass, in black current constraints from supercamiocande, in blue projection for hypercamiocande, in red our parameter space. So as of today, there are no constraints, but hypercamiocande could test this region of parameter space provided the annihilation is S-wave and two neutrinos. And the final possibility that we outline is maybe the dark sector is a little bit more complex and there are additional dark sector states that carry varying numbers. Then the gain will change. And to highlight the point, we consider a new scalar baryon with baryon number 1/3. So it's a standard model singlet. It has a baryon number the same as a quark, but this is a standard model singlet that doesn't have any strong interactions. And this particle is very interesting because in the early universe, one could transfer the asymmetry in the dark sector into these states, and the particle will be automatically stable because it carries baryon number of 1/3. If baryon number is exactly conserved, it cannot decay into anything. Now, if this particle makes up the entirety of the dark matter, in order to explain the ratio between dark matter and baryon abundance of 5, the mass of this particle will be roughly 1.6 GeV. So out of the three, I think this is the most interesting one because this particle is automatically stable if your baryon number is conserved, which is the assumption of the mechanism. And then it could give you an understanding of why there is 5 times more energy density in dark matter than in baryonic matter. From the detection of the dark sector of the dark matter, I have worse news. So it's harder to test than other scenarios. And essentially this is because there is no direct coupling between dark matter and light quarks. The coupling is indirect and typically through heavy quarks. So we couple to a big quark. Now, an indirect coupling can be generated to light quarks. It will be indirect and it will be generated through weak loops. And then one could imagine having these type of processes. So a dark matter particle comes in from the halo. It interacts with a neutron in a vector, say in supercamiocande, and it yields another dark matter particle in the final state and 2 kms. So this is possible given our interactions. The problem is the rate for this process is tiny, and therefore one cannot actually observe it. So that's unfortunate, but yeah, on the other hand, from the collider perspective, we have better prospects. So to summarize, we developed a mechanism for baryogenesis and dark matter from the CP Belle II oscillations and subsequent decays of B-mesons in the early universe. Within B-mesogenesis, the baryon asymmetry of the universe, or the number of baryons divided by the number of photons, is directly related to the CP violation in the neutral B-meson system. And in our setup, baryon number is conserved, and this gives us an understanding for dark matter, which will be anti-baryonic. If the mechanism is at play in the early universe, it will lead to a distinct experimental signatures, and in particular to a positive semi-electronic asymmetry in B-meson decays, with a level 10 Yes, Gordon?
Oh, no, please continue. I just...
Okay. Okay, let me finish this and then you ask the question. Sorry. So it would lead to if the mechanism is at play in the early universe, we will have a positive semi-electronic asymmetry in one of the B mesons, at least one of them, and should be positive at larger than 10 to the minus 5. And both neutral and charged B mesons should decay into baryons at Mason energy with a branching fraction larger than 10 to the minus 4. There are ongoing searches for these type of processes at BaBar, Belle, and Belle II. And given the sensitivity of B factories to other processes involving Mason energy channels like P2K and UNU, we expect them to be able to test the full parameter space. Even if they are not able, then we expect that a combination of measurements at Atlas, CMS, and LHCb should be able to fully test the parameter space. So, do you mind, Gordon, waiting for, I know you're running over time, but like 2 more minutes, I say some work for Outlook and then I finish. It's good? Good, good, I will be fast. So I think something interesting to consider is, are the flavor anomalies in B2S mu mu transitions related to our mechanism? Why? Because C-prime models and leptoquarks generically alter the oscillation pattern of B-mesons. So maybe there is a relationship. We don't know, we didn't explore that in detail. Are there other possibilities for that sector? I outlined 3, but there could be more. You know, what type of UV theory allows us to have a triplet scalar at the TV scale and dark matter particles at the UV scale? A nice example is supersymmetry. And I point you to this paper by Gonzalo, Gillian, and Wang Yu. But there could be others. This is a little bit technical and I'm going to discuss it, but you know, we have to do some QCD calculations. If there are any experts, I will be happy to discuss them. Essentially, baryogenesis cares about this inclusive decay, but the experimentalists can search for this exclusive one, and we need to relate them. We did it doing a very rough calculation, but an actual QCD calculation will be very valuable. There are also decays for B-flavored baryons. One could potentially modify the with mixing in this scenario. And the final question is, well, how well will BaBar, Belle, and Belle II constrain, and who knows, potentially measure this branching fraction? So with this, and I really take you only 10 more seconds, I would like to introduce you to the rest of the B-Mesogenesis team, because I give you the talk, but I'm not the only one doing this. And actually, on the opposite, I've been surrounded by outstanding collaborators. So we have Gonzalo Alonso Alvarez. He finished his PhD thesis in Heidelberg 5 months ago. He moved to McGill, so he's in your continent, so keep an eye on him. Also, Guillermo, she's a postdoc in the University of Washington, and she's actually moving to Germany. So she's going to be closer to me, but keep an eye on her virtually. And finally, Nelson, who was, I think some of you may know, passed away 1.5 years ago in a climbing accident, and who was the pioneer of the ideas I've been telling you about, and who we, you know, are really grateful to and we really miss. So with this, I would like to thank you for the kind invitation and to thank my collaborators for the hard work and key ideas. And now it's time for questions and comments.
Thank you, Miguel. That was very interesting and very novel. Gordon, let me let you go ahead.
Oh, thanks. And thanks for a great talk. I just wanted to clarify a couple of things that I might have missed. So in your picture, you have the phi initially decaying to BB bar in the early universe. Now, I assume that you have some pre-existing radiation that's part of the story, that the phi is not itself the particle that gives rise to the radiation bath. Is that right?
Well, there is some in also radiation, but then essentially when this particle starts to decay, its energy density is, say, 10 to the 4 times larger than the bath that was pre-existing.
Okay, so it dominates.
It dominates.
So my question is, I know you checked the scattering to see how it affects the CP phases through the charge radius process, but I'm wondering if it's also relevant to consider weak interactions. So like you have a B meson that's now surrounded by this radiation bath,
and say it hits a lepton, exchanges a W, and becomes a lighter meson. Would that spoil the story?
But in at these temperatures, the electroweak interactions are strongly penalized, right? Compared to the electromagnetic ones.
That's true, yeah. So my I don't know how, it could be a situation where you need it to scatter lots of times electromagnetically to spoil the mechanism, but you'd only need to scatter once through the weak interactions to get rid of a B-meson.
So what do you mean, like annihilating? So removing a B?
Removing the B, but not necessarily, not self-annihilation, but like annihilation of a lepton.
But, right, so that, but to into going into which final state?
I don't know my mesonic weak interactions well enough to give you a good answer, but like, let's say it goes into a kaon of appropriate charge. You go from an electron to a neutrino, and then you go from a B meson to a kaon.
Probably to a charm meson, I don't know. Maybe make the charge right.
Yeah, I mean, any one of them is.
Want to see a W exchange, right? So that.
Yeah, exactly.
My intuition is that at this temperature, the W extending is strongly suppressed because you know you cannot produce it. It's only virtual, right?
Yeah.
The interaction rate is way smaller than electromagnetic interactions.
But it's way bigger than Hubble.
But I guess the decay always wins over the annihilation, right?
Sure. The key time scale here is not Hubble, mm-hmm. it's the lifetime of the B-meson.
Mm-hmm.
And the lifetime of the B-meson is the picosecond. It's super short.
Gotcha.
So it is true. Mm-hmm. The interactions are the rate divided by Hubble at 20 MeV is 10 to the 4 of the electroweak interactions, but that is nowhere close to the lifetime of the business.
Mm, very good. So just one other quick question. So at the end, you mentioned the CMB constraint on the dark matter.
mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering why that's necessary in your scenario, because you already have a locked in anti-baryon number in the dark sector. And so couldn't you just pick your favorite annihilation rate to just get rid of all your dark antiparticles and that's that? They don't annihilate at CMB time.
No, because then we will only explain so this particle carries baryon number 1 and this particle carries 0 baryon number because it's a Majorana fermion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, right.
We know there should be the same number of these guys as baryons.
Mm-hmm.
And we know the mass is below 2.5 GeVs.
Mm-hmm.
So that means we can only explain at most, if these particles were the only ones, 50% of the dark matter of the universe. Which mm-hmm. means that the remaining should be coming from these states and they should have a given abundance. Otherwise, you miss part of it. The only scenario that will explain this is this scenario. And that's why I like it, because in this scenario, yes, your baryon asymmetry is you have the same baryon number in the dark sector, but since this particle carries baryon number just one cell, you can have many of them, even if they are lighter.
Mm-hmm.
And that allows you to have the observed one and annihilate the remaining symmetry component.
Cool, thank you.
Sungwoo, did you have a question?
Yeah, so I had a 3, but you just answered my last question, so that's great. Yeah, I understand this argument. Okay, awesome. So the first quick question is that in your case, you don't have to worry about the washout process because it is really multi-to-1 process instead of 2-to-1 in usual case. So it's completely suppressed. Is that the right reasoning?
Can you repeat that again?
So usually when you do have like baryogenesis or some genesis processes, often you have to worry about possible washing out processes. For example, in the case of leptogenesis, you have to worry about inverse decay, that washing out the mm-hmm. thing, mm-hmm. or two scattering that wash out the two units of number. But in your case, it is like B decaying into many number of final states. So the inverse process is completely suppressed. Is that the reason why you didn't have to worry about the...
So the reason is not that there are many final states, but it's essentially that the mass of the B meson is, say, 5 GeVs, and the temperature is 10, 20 MeV. So the inverse decay process is penalized by e to the minus n divided by t.
Oh, no, actually, I was more questioning about the last phase of the process, really B meson decaying into dark stuff plus standard amount of stuff.
Yeah, yeah, similar story. Okay. It's impossible to from the plasma 20 MeV to reconstruct a B meson.
Yeah, okay. Good. And then second question is that I feel that you must have perturbativity constraint on the mass of the Y. Basically, if you look at the branching ratio, it is suppressed by the force power and then coupling. So if you raise the mass of the Y at some point, you hit the perturbativity bound. Am I right?
Yes. So there is some, let me, yes, yes. You're absolutely right. I didn't show this plot. Let me, sorry, I should have it. Yes. So can you see this plot?
Yes, I can see.
Yes, so essentially this is what you are saying precisely in terms of the parameter space. And then this is the branching fraction. Mm-hmm. This is in the directly through the bias and CMS. And you can see that if you go to too large of a mass of this size, then the companies that you need are too large, and then Alders and CMS have seen nothing, and therefore is excluded or constrained. So yes, the mass of this particle cannot be too heavy. Okay. Too heavy. Clearly should be below the mass difference between the bottom, the B quark and the B meson and the proton, but it cannot be actually lighter than 3.5 GeV. Otherwise, the couplings that you need are not necessarily bounded by perturbativity, but too large.
I see.
And then they will be excluded.
I see. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you for the question.
Awesome. Let me stop.